like to welcome you all to this panel. My name is Emma Frans, and I'm a researcher and epidemiologist working at Karolinska Institutet. I'm also a science writer writing for Svenska Dagbladet. And I would like to present to you this distinguished panel. First, we have Maggie Haberman. You're a White House correspondent for New York Times and also a political analyst for CNN. Mm-hmm. And we have Catherine Meyer, and you're the executive director for Wikimedia Foundation. And we also have Professor Frank Wilczek. You're a Nobel laureate and also an author and columnist for Wall Street Journal.
Yes.
So today we will talk about facts. And in many senses, journalists and scientists and also people working with Wikipedia are on the quest for truth and also work with collecting facts in different ways. And Maggie, you are a journalist and you have been covering Trump for many years, and he is not always giving us the correct facts, one would say. Maybe it's an understatement.
Yes, that was very diplomatically put.
Yes. But how is it to be someone that is searching for the truth? How is it to report on someone telling lies? And when you give people the facts, you're actually giving people lies.
So, it's a great question. I want to read to you a tweet that our president did about half an hour ago, 34 minutes ago. There was a story yesterday, just for some background, that CNN, which I am a contributor for, ran an erroneous story that they corrected several hours later about his son, Donald Trump Jr., and whether WikiLeaks had tried giving him advance information, which was not the case, just if you looked at the dates. They corrected the story, but this is what the president tweeted. Fake news CNN made a vicious and purposeful mistake yesterday. They were caught red-handed, just like lonely Brian Ross at ABC News, who should be immediately fired for his quote-unquote mistake. That doesn't even matter. That's several stories ago. Watch to see if CNN fires those responsible, or was it just gross incompetence? And then he did a follow-up one later. So CNN clearly made an error, and they corrected it, because that is what legitimate news outlets do, is when you make an error, we correct it as quickly as possible, and hopefully without defensiveness. He then takes that and says something that's just not true, that this was done to hurt him. But we have very limited tools as journalists to challenge that, because he's basically stating a feeling, which is his truth. There is no fact to back it up, but there's also no fact to argue against it. And so I would say that that summarizes what most of our year has been. one of the challenges of covering this administration, one of many, during the campaign, some of the Trump aides would tell reporters fake information. I don't think they were always doing it intentionally, but sometimes it was to see what would get written. We have to be able to trust our sources like never before, and that will often mean not running information because we are concerned about its value. So it is a challenge that I have never faced like this, and a few of my colleagues have.
Okay. Catherine, how do you avoid reporting on false things? Because we talked a little bit about this earlier. How do someone report on for instance, the alt-right, or even people who are spreading lies about science, such as flat earthers or people? How do you write a Wikipedia article about chemtrails? Because should you ignore it? Is it better to ignore it, or how should you describe this phenomenon?
Yeah, Wikipedia has an approach that relies very heavily on secondary sources. So as I sit here between an academic and a journalist, thank you for all the work that you do, because we could not be possible without your work. So it concerns me greatly when people talk about erosion of trust in these institutions, because there was a statistic study that came out that Brits trust Wikipedia more than they trust the BBC. That's a terrible state of affairs. we look to secondary sources, reliable secondary sources, which means that they have to have a characteristic and way of approaching information. They have to issue corrections when they get things wrong, as Maggie was talking about earlier. They have to go through a process of peer review. They have to fact check the work that they do. And if that's the case, then we consider them a reliable source. And that actually varies widely depending on the sector you're writing about. And that is the basis of all the information that exists in Wikipedia. And the reason we have those citations is so that when things are wrong, people can go and correct them. When it comes to things like fringe theories, we treat them like fringe theories. We say the preponderance of evidence says this. When it comes to climate change, we're not going to say objectivity, one side on this, one side on the other. Anthropogenic climate change, if you were sitting here a moment ago, science tells us pretty clearly what it is. So the Wikipedia article on that, in English at least, is about this much on this climate science, about this much on the political controversy, and about that much on the citations. Mm-hmm. And I think that that's the way that you handle these things, is you don't give equal weight to controversy. You call out controversy for what it is, and you call out the facts for what they are.
In Sweden, we have had this ongoing debate about how journalists should handle the alternative right, Nazism, and so on. And sometimes a Nazi is invited to a TV show to talk about Nazism. Do you see? And that's not the way that you go about it in Wikipedia, I'm guessing.
No. in fact, I like Twitter a lot. And although I've blocked the president, so I don't have to see him in my feed. The way that this works on Wikipedia is that we talk about the comprehensive history, and we're in a slightly different place that I think is very fortunate, and that the press doesn't necessarily have the luxury of. We don't have to do a narrow slice of the day. We get to do the contextual history from start to finish of an issue, and that I think of it as slow information, or it's like slow news to some extent, because things accrete over time until you have a very comprehensive understanding of the context. And I think that's why Wikipedia is very valuable as a complementary asset to the information that is being produced on a daily basis, whether that is in the sciences or whether that is in the state area of current affairs.
So we have this fast information here and the slow information, as you call it, and then science is, I would say, an even slower way of finding knowledge.
It is. It's, I think, not qualitatively different from what Wikipedia does. We have a variety of institutions. We have journals, we have societies, we have peer review, and we have a kind of consensus typically about the state of our subjects. It's not always correct. There are famous cases of mistakes, but things get checked, at least in many branches of science. You can repeat experiments, and things that don't look quite right, they get checked. Theories get put forward that may not be correct. In fact, adventurous theories very often aren't correct, but they're subject to the discipline of experimental check. Sometimes you have to be very patient. Gravitational waves took 100 years. Higgs boson took 50 years. Microwave background radiation, close to 50 years. But the process, nature is the ultimate judge. And that's what makes science special, I think.
I read an interview with you yesterday in Dagens Nyheter.
I think it was this morning.
Yeah. And I got the impression that you're constantly working, mm-hmm. and also that there's a very high tempo. Do you think this fast pace of journalism is affecting the quality and the accuracy of your work or others' work?
I try to keep it from affecting the accuracy of my work as little as possible, but there is no question that the pace has had what I consider to be a deleterious impact on journalism in general. I think Twitter is a disaster, and I would love for Twitter to go away for a variety of reasons. But what it has done, and it was not really around in 2008. Its first real presidential cycle in U.S. politics was 2012, and already at that point it was having this uptick in activity and impacting what were already quickened paces at daily newspapers that were online at that point, and we were all kind of updating stories as we went along. Twitter has no context. Now we have a whopping 280 characters so instead of 140. It is very easy to... It leaves sort of a sheen a residue of something that happened, but it's not an actual fact. It is not actual detail. Mm-hmm. So, for instance, a lot of people I found were getting their sense of what Trump would say at rallies from picking off of Twitter. You really need to watch his whole rally to understand what he was saying, how sort of staccato and all over the place the messaging was, but also how he would use repetition, how sort of insidious some of his words were. I don't know what the answer for it is, other than that everybody needs to slow down. But because everybody is competing so aggressively, it's really hard. So, for instance, the CNN story that I read you before, it was an honest mistake. The reporters were told the wrong date. But had they taken an extra few hours and done a search of what had been reported before, and maybe they did do some cursory search, but it would have shown up that they had their date wrong. And so I do worry about that. I think that everybody needs to slow down, but as long as there is this global competition for news, that isn't going to happen.
Yes. Well, we talk about this attention economy nowadays, that there's an abundance of information and what we are competing, the limiting factor that people are competing for right now is the attention of people. And I'm guessing that in that sense, it's important to be fast, maybe even more important to be absolutely correct with everything.
Both speed, when I started work, I worked in New York City tabloids for a long time. And I had an editor who used to say at the New York Post, which is where I began my career, cares only about being first. The New York Times cares only about being right. And we care about being first and right at the Times, but
I would say that
there can be, and I think it's really important to be mindful of that tension and what can end up happening. Where I think the danger is not just the speed on its own, and not just the need to compete broadly, but people are so self-selecting in their media sources now, which I think is part of why Wikipedia is both wonderful and also can allow people to use it in ways that are not well intended. But people basically can choose their own adventure with the news. Mm-hmm. There is no, it used to be, you know, Walter Cronkite, the New York Times, and these various establishment media in the U.S., those were your truth tellers. Those were your factual choices. Because there has been such an erosion of trust, not just in U.S. media, but globally, people are choosing their own sites and they choose what to believe. Yep. And I think that is the challenge, is how to get people... It's very funny. how to get people listening to you and trusting you.
Catherine, you're quite, at Wikipedia, you're quite good at getting people's attention. Why do you believe that?
Well, I think that there's just nothing quite like it out there. I mean, and part of the reason, there's probably lots of reasons for that, but people need places that they can go, as I mentioned earlier, for context. They need a complement to the information that's happening in the world around them, both in current affairs, but also, I mean, you're doing your homework. You look things up. We see the cycles of, you know, the school year come and go over the seasons. But I think one thing that's really different for us is we talked about the attention economy. The attention economy is heavily predicated on the business model for that economy. The economy part is the critical word that I would underscore. And we, as a nonprofit, are not monetizing for clicks. We're not thinking about how we promote certain trending topics or content over others. And that actually gives us tremendous permission to both get it right-ish, you know, and then iterate in the scientific method fashion, but also to create that trust with our readership and not necessarily put ourselves in the same risk of, like, do you get it right first and then get it wrong and then break that cycle? Right, and I think that is a critical difference that we have. And I was listening to Joseph Stiglitz earlier talking about the economy of the press and how important that is in terms of building these institutions that are trusted. I would love to see more of nonprofit investment or non-commercialized investment. And even institutions that are non-commercialized, like The Guardian in the UK, still must compete in this sort of ad-based economy, which has been only exacerbated by the consolidation of that marketplace by companies like Google and Facebook. And I think that is a fundamental transformation in the way that information is distributed, and it's very unhealthy for our information ecosystem.
And in science, we are not very good right now, I would say, at getting people's attention.
It's a challenge.
It is
sometimes.
A challenge. And can facts ever compete with people with lies?
I think if I could summarize all of this in a sort of global way, In recent years, we've developed a signal-to-noise problem. Mm-hmm. As the noise has cranked way up.
Yes.
And the signal hasn't caught up.
That's right.
Wikipedia, I think, is a wonderful model for how the signal can be amplified, you know, where the noise gets pared away. And I think the younger generation works with Wikipedia a lot, is more sophisticated about judging news sources. They, I trust and I hope, and I think we should encourage, will be able to filter out the noise better and find the signal in this flood of information.
Do you think scientists have an important role in this, in teaching people
how to keep science is the best approximation we have to pure signal. And I don't know if science and its institutions was part of the model for how Wikipedia works.
Absolutely.
But it is remarkable how many of the same kind of institutional arrangements are working in Wikipedia, and I think it's a great thing. And we, you know, all I can say is more please. And on the science side, we have to keep a kind of humility about what we can supply. There are questions we can't answer for sure, but also pride in what we can answer, and trying to convey that really there are things we do know that aren't negotiable, and it's a process. We just have to keep at it and do it right, be honest at every stage, and that'll eventually win through, I'm confident.
In my field of research, medical research, we have a lot of problem with people are competing very much. So it's a high competition right now during science. And I think that is problematic. And also we have these scientific frauds coming out now. And also a lot of exaggerations also going on when scientists are out communicating. Do you have any comments on this and how we can...
Well, I think we also we have to convey that science is not one thing. Mm. There are different parts of science that have different problems, different levels of credibility. And yes, the parts that are very driven by economic factors or driven by cutthroat competition have problems that the sort of more conventional central parts of science don't have. So I think we need to be very careful about talking about science in general and make more nuanced distinctions that some things are more reliable than others.
So Maggie, I'm going to ask you this question as well. Can the politicians telling the truth ever compete with the ones that are lying?
Well, the problem is, it's a good question. The problem with is that it treats everything like a binary. Mm-hmm. Almost every politician I have ever covered lies to some degree or another. And so this helped Trump succeed in the election because his supporters and even not his supporters would look at outlets like mine. I mean, I was part of lists where we would say, you know, Trump's lies, falsehoods, statesmanlike, you know, salesmanlike stretches. They would look at us doing that and say, well, but you didn't do this kind of a list for Barack Obama when he exaggerated on what the Affordable Care Act would do. You know, you didn't say when Hillary Clinton, you know, said she was shot at in Bosnia, you didn't, although I would argue she was pilloried for that, but and that was hardly a light news day. So it's the question is sort of where the line is, and you have to accept that everything is a sliding scale. That doesn't mean we should not say that he is something unlike what we have seen before in that office or in any major office in the U.S. I mean, the Trump candidacy began as, and he continues to act as a fringe candidate, which is the most amazing thing, and seeing that in the White House. So I think that part of it is that we actually have to find where the balance is between making clear what a fact is, which is a little different than what the truth is, frankly. And I think that we are still figuring our way on that.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. Well, we are finished now. Thank you. I'm going to leave you with this kind of short-term negative, maybe long-term positive view.
None of my panels have ended very happily today. Sorry.
Okay. But thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.